Thank you very much, Giovanna, for this introduction. You said everything. I don't know what else is for me to add. Thank you very much for coming, and thank you to the CCA for inviting us, our office, Point Supreme, to talk about our work here. It's a big honor, and we're very happy to be here and visit this institution. So tonight I'm gonna show you some of our work. It's split in five chapters. I will start with a small introduction of Athens, how we read Athens, what Athens means for us, because that's the only way for you to understand the work. So Athens is a city in the center of Greece where half of the population of the country lives. So 5 million people live in the area, and it's this. And the city is encircled by mountains on three sides, and then the sea on the fourth side, the Aegean Sea, in fact, the beautiful waters that connect the city to the islands, to the archipelago. And the city is completely built up. So you see this is all a concrete sea, out of which only the small hills stick out of. So this is the Acropolis, the Parthenon on top, and then Lykavitos, the tallest hill. You will see all of that soon. This is a zoom up of the center, the historical center. So this is the Acropolis with the Parthenon here, the Lykavitos hill, the tallest one, the main triangle. You see that the whole city is built up, apart from the hills and some ancient remains of antiquities, archaeological sites. But in fact, Athens is only communicated as this. That's what everybody thinks of Athens, the Acropolis. All the postcards are about the Acropolis, and all the tourists basically know the Acropolis. This is a real picture of it sitting in the city. So nobody really knows or pays attention to what happens around, which is the actual city, the contemporary city. You see the islands already appearing in the background. And if we zoom into a typical neighborhood of Athens, you see that this is the texture of it. So it's like I told you, it's completely built up with polykatikias, it's called, this housing block unit. It's very small scale, and it follows the same regulations. So it has this peculiar form. This is a close-up of it. So it has this profile in order to allow the sun to reach the street. And to show a smaller scale than it actually is towards the ground floor, the street level. And this is a painting of Spiros Vassiliou, a painter we really appreciate, an older painter from the 60s, where you see a reading of the city that we very much relate to. You see that the city is this continuous built substance on which is the continuous rooftop level. And above you, all the omnipresent mountains, and over it, the beautiful sky with the light and the blue, strong blue color. So if we zoom out a bit, you see this is Athens, what we just saw, Attica, the wider area, the peninsula, and then the islands already appearing maybe 20 minutes far by boat. So it's very important to remember that, in fact, if you drive from the center, from the Acropolis, towards the coast, in 15 minutes, you reach this. So it's already the Aegean Sea. It's really beautiful. And if you drive a little bit further down along the coast, like in 20 minutes, you start discovering this sort of beach. That is kind of a non-spoken secret. Even Athenians, a lot of Athenians don't know about this already, although it's really there. Because, of course, Greek people are spoiled. We have the island, so nobody pays attention to the actual beauty that is lying around Athens. So let's start with our Athens projects. We'll start. We have put together first some general ones that have to do with the whole city. These projects were collected together in a book that got published in Chicago under the Graham Foundation last year. The series is being, I saw that it's being sold in the bookshop of the CCA, and that was very exciting. And so there's a series of projects about Athens, ideas about Athens that we have been collecting since all these years that we were living and working abroad. And these ideas are collected in notebooks like this one. And they are all sorts of ideas, all sorts of projects. They vary from radical to immediately realizable, small and big. And they have certain, they always have relationships. They form a kind of series that make the whole city a continuous field of exploration for us. So very often we try to map or understand the relationships between the projects in maps like this that keep us aware of all the relationships and you know, oppositions or complements between projects. This is some sketches to as an example of different phases of the same thing. So for example, this is about a project called the Greek Archipelago that has never been finalized yet. This is different moments of it. And so let's start with the first project we did about Athens, which was this. It was called The Legitimization of the Undervalued. And the point was to talk about the Polykatikia, this housing block that makes the city. Because nobody is talking about it, and if you ask a typical Athens residents, they will tell you they hate it. So we thought to try to look at its potential, to try to elevate it into an icon, because that's what it is, that's what makes the city, so there must be more to it. So we did a pretty complex project with totally different products in it. So one part was a campaign, a tourist campaign, which included this series of stamps that we seriously proposed to the municipality. So instead of showing temples and the Acropolis on the stamps, to show Polykatikias, which is the real condition of the city. Then there was this image, the triptych, which showed the hidden tendency of the city. So, you know, the Polykatikias keep rising, and then they at some point they stop. But what we showed is that, in fact, the tendency they have is to just swallow the rest of the remains of the natural territory. At the this was 2008, and at the time they were still going on fires in the summer. So basically, that's the reason why they would happen. So this sort of image became very provocative, of course, and it was in the papers, in the newspapers, and created a lot of discussions. Another part of that project, the first project, was this, an exhibition of 100 Polykatikias that became icons. So they tried to, each one tried to solve or reflect a different condition of the city, a problem usually. So it tried to create a public space on it, for example, or opening, or just had color all of a sudden. Or it was just 100 reactions to the norm. There was even, in fact, one Polykatikia that was disguised as a hill, the Lykavitos Hill. And then after that project, we got a certain publicity that surprised us even. That's a part of a big article in the most popular newspaper magazine, Sunday newspaper magazine, that talked about the project. And that was a very critical moment, because somehow these projects actually address the public, the residents of Athens. They don't address the academia or other architects. They're really addressed to people. So we realized that as soon as these projects became published in typical newspapers and magazines, then they kind of became complete. This is another project, similar to the previous one, though, that was called Athens Section. So the argument was that since Polykatikia is the only typology of building built in Greece, in Athens, then of course every sort of program has to happen inside, which is the case. So you find swimming pools, supermarkets, cinemas, theaters, any kind of thing, gas stations, in Polykatikias. So we made this image that kind of showed all this typical stuff you find inside. The Acropolis is in the back, the hill, the mountain, the metro going below. Because the city is this, and that was the point, that actually a section through the Polykatikia is a section through the city. And this image became the cover of a very popular free press, LIFO, where they had an issue with the topic of ideal home. So they asked us to do an image that showed an ideal home, and obviously, you know, this was an issue, a commercial issue that would have companies, furniture companies, and show things like that, design objects, and they were expecting something in that line. But we used this, we did this image for this magazine, in fact, so they put it in the cover. They cut the metro because it was too dark, of course, and they added a bit of clouds and pink color, but still it made the cover of it. And then there was announced the topic of the second Athens Art Biennale, which was heaven. And we thought that was such an interesting topic. So we thought, why not do a project about that and propose it to them? So we thought, or we asked ourselves, how would Athens become heaven? What's missing to it? And we soon found out that Athens has the smallest amount of green per person. In Europe there's a minimum, and Athens is 3 times below, while most European capitals are 10 times over. So we actually calculated the size of the missing green, and it's this big. So we proposed this plan. We proposed to place this exact green to replace the municipality that's in between the Acropolis and the coast. So to reconnect the Acropolis to the water like it used to be, a connection that's lost, obviously. And we made this image for that. So this is Athens heaven. And we sent it to the, we sent the whole project actually to the Biennale, and we never got a reply. But this image became extremely popular and published again. So this is a few examples of that kind of publication. So it's very interesting. The titles are very interesting because they're very direct. They're like, this is what I want my city to be, for example. So all these projects are self-initiated, and basically they were attacking the lack of visions for the future of the city from authorities. And at the same time, what happens is that they kind of created a new political and critical role for us architects. So it made us involved in that. Then another one of the Athens project is this one. It had to do with the hills. So it's called Athens by Hills. So this is a real postcard. We collect postcards of Athens, and you see the relationship of the tall hill Kavitos and the Acropolis, the sea in the back. And this is an image we did for this project called the Tribute to Madelon, which claims that Likavitos, which is a male name in Greek, has a secret affair with Acropolis, which is a female name in Greek language, and their offspring is the Polykatikia. And what we did was to react to the fact that it's only Acropolis that communicates the idea of Athens, while there's all this network of hills, different hills, very exciting, very interesting, and very unknown. So we started to map them down and to look at the different programs that already exist on them and to propose to emphasize those programs. And so to create a campaign, and I'm an image of Athens, an understanding of Athens, which is based on all these hills with their existing programs, but also with additions to it to intensify, also with adding a few extra new hills like this one as an island to connect to the Aegean islands. And there was a part of that project was a postcard, this postcard, which just collected all types of mountain typologies, extreme opposite typologies, to show a little bit the ambition in it. And also we made a toy-like model of Athens, which showed this continuous rooftop level and the hill sticking out and the programs, the different programs. And this project also made the cover of different newspapers and magazines. And a similar project to that, the Athens by Hills, is this one. This is an image of a series of paintings of Hokusai and Hiroshige in Japan, which were called the 100 Views of Mountain Fuji. The Fujiyama is the sacred mountain in Japan. So they made a series of 100 pictures where they showed the mountain in different conditions, in different seasons, in different times of the day, with different things happening around. So you think you're looking at 100 pictures of the Fujiyama mountain, but in fact what is happening is that you're looking at different programs, life in Edo at the time, So we thought that that was a very good tool to talk about Athens, but using the Acropolis as an excuse. So we started to collect 100. We're actually, it's in process. We want to make a book of it. A series of 100 pictures that's of the images of the Acropolis, where actually you're looking at 100 different programs around or different conditions. So this is and it's all real photographs. This is a photograph with a sports and a running track looking directly at the Parthenon, really above, which is standing just above it. And in fact, we contacted all the photographers we admire very much in Greece, and all of them happily agreed to collaborate with us, so to give us pictures. So, for example, this one is by Alexandros Philippidis, a super interesting photographer. This is an image through the Philopappou Hill in the back of the Parthenon. This is again from us. It's a typical rooftop in the center of in the center of Athens, with a pool, you know, tourists sunbathing, and the Acropolis behind. And then this is another project called Athens as an Island, which is very much linked to the ones you just saw, which proposed a campaign which shows Athens as an island, actually. Because in fact, the city is really like the capital cities on the Greek islands. Why? Because the city is built around the tallest hill in the center, which has the monastery or temple or church on top. And then around it is the sea with boats that connect the island to the rest of the islands and make it part of a network. So it's exactly the case with the city of Athens. In fact, if you look at under the Acropolis, this is a real photograph again, you will notice that in fact Athens is like an island city there. So this is Plaka area. It's the first settlement of the modern city, which was actually built by islanders that came to Attica to build Athens, and what they built was island architecture, because that's what they knew. So this is also an image that became very popular with people, and in fact it made the cover even of a summer city guide for tourists in 2003, and that was very interesting, and there's a lot of anecdotes about it. For example, in the summer sometimes we walk in the city and we see this picture printed and put in the door, glass door of shops that are closed for holidays. And it says, below it says, closed for holidays, I'll be back in September. So it really became absorbed by people. And another project that is also in continuity to this one, Athens as an Island, is this one. It's a competition that we won the first prize for. Faliro Pier, it's called. So this is Athens again, and the waterfront, like I told you, is completely neglected. Its potential completely, not paid attention to. And so there's going to be three piers built on the coast there, and they asked architects to propose an icon to place on the end of one pier. So they were expecting wavy, you know, impressive objects that looked like the sea, and that's what the rest of the prizes were like. But what we proposed was instead to use this point at the end of the pier to program it, to use it like a station, like a stop, and to create routes, to put a ferry boat, a ready-made ferry boat there, and to create routes that take you to different types of journeys around the coast. For example, with performances or seminars or things happening during this boat that could also stop in on islands, and also to bring water taxis, which is something that we don't have in Greece, so that people can actually take water taxis and go to all these amazing beaches around instead of driving or taking the bus there. So this is the other prizes, all the other prizes of the competition. And this is our proposal, which was to use a ready-made object, an archetype of the Greek sea as well, and to put attention not on the design or on the object, but turn this into the icon. So this was the project. This is the station with a big tribune, a restaurant on top, a public plaza here, the water taxis parking on both sides, and the ferry boat in front. And it had a very strong graphic character in order for the project to be, to belong in this representation that all these marine objects have that are super graphic. This was a catalog of the beaches. This is real photographs of beaches around Athens that we showed to support the argument. And this is some pictures that inspired the representation of the color, the graphic color character of the project. This is the project in inside with the hills behind the ferry boat. This is an image by night. So this project was also very much in the press. It actually, this one created a lot of debates, and there was a lot of reactions against it because a lot of people simply wanted to have the wavy icon instead. Of course, the big canopy above was a thing to create shadow, because that's a huge problem in Greece, especially in the summer. You cannot sit anywhere if there's no shadow. And this is the models that we presented in the Venice Biennale in 2012 that Giovanna mentioned before. So what we decided to do is to present a selection of the Athens projects, the main image of every project, but on a podium that presented a kind of action or detail that reveals a kind of hidden aspect of the project or creates a certain dialogue with it. So that was a very interesting project actually for us, because we ourselves discovered different elements to the project that we were not conscious of before. This is a zoom in, for example, with a captain in front of the ferry boat project. This you didn't see. This you will see soon. Oh, this is heaven. You saw this one. This you will see soon, the theater square. And then after all this, we did a project which is a little bit different, which is a real tourist campaign. So it came with souvenirs that are at the moment being actually sold in shops in Greece. The campaign is called Only in Athens, and this is the logo. The logo is like a contemporary metope, where you see all the buildings, the typologies that make up the city today, the Polykatikia profile that you know, the Byzantine church somewhere close, the kiosk in every urban block, a beach umbrella somewhere not too far, and some kind of ancient remain also around the corner. So we created a list of or a series of images. For example, this one that shows that your view in Athens is always framed by this Polykatikia profile. Or this one, which showed the sculptural aspect of Polykatikias in relation to ancient sculpture. This one, which is about the open-air cinemas that are hidden, secret, amazing spaces in Athens. This one is about the stray dogs that are omnipresent and sleep on columns. This is a real photograph of graffiti during the crisis, which spelled resist on top of the columns of the National Library. This one was one of the just typical images of Athens, a balcony. This one was replacing a temple with Polykatikia in a traditional network. And then we also made these marble Polykatikia little statues that were sold instead of, you know, the typical marble statue of goddess Athena and god Zeus and Poseidon and all that. And this is some of the other objects. Like a fridge magnet of Athens as an island, and small mosaics of Polykatikias, and a typical island tablecloth of Athens. And this is some of the t-shirts. We also promoted Lykavitos instead of Acropolis Hill, etc. So let's look at some specific case studies of Athens projects where they are tested on specific sites in the city. Before we show you these Athens cases, we decided to show you this picture, which is one of the first things we ever did as an office. It was participation in a Japanese competition, Shinkechinku competition. That year it had the topic called the House of Resale Value. And the question was, how can you design something, a house, whose value you can guarantee that it keeps raising? So our reply was that the value of the house depends on the surrounding, on the context. So even if you take a masterpiece and place it in a very bad conditioned context, then the value will drop. So that's an idea that keeps being behind our Athens work. because, as you see, also because Athens is so dense and built up and everything, context is really an issue. Context is really, like, reality is really part of the projects. That's what is very critical and very strongly present in our work. So this is an example of a typical public space in Athens. In fact, it's the most central roundabout square, Omonia Square. So you see the condition. So it's really lacking optimism, lacking joy, lacking imagination. In fact, there's no nature. Nature is really like a decoration. It's a totally hard and unpleasant surface. So let's look at some of the case study projects. So this is called a square. This is in fact is classified like a square. It's called Theater Square. It's actually more like a parking, as you see. It's in the center of Athens, so Acropolis is just behind the corner here. And there was a competition to redesign it. And of course, they were expecting, and in fact, the first prize is about just repaving the surface and adding a couple of trees. But what we thought to do was to make a tribute to nature, like to celebrate nature, to use nature not as a decorative element, but really hardcore use of it, to be all about that. And in fact, because Acropolis is just above, if this thing had a three-dimensional presence, then you could also see it from the Acropolis. So it's like a hidden room, this space, but you see, you only discover it when you enter, but then it could be seen from above. So we proposed to make a garden that was that would work on different levels. So on top it would reflect this, it would refer to the city, and then on the ground, in, you know, it would deal with the actual daily life in Athens. And these were some of the sketches for it. And so this was an image from the top, because the square has abandoned office buildings around, so we proposed to turn them into housing. So we added balconies like this one. So from top you would see this, and then when you went down, you would be among this grid of tree trunks with different flowers that have all kinds of smells and colors and all that. So the effort or the ambition was to give, and this is the same for all these projects, is to give public space again a cultural role, and add the imagination and optimism to it, and to make it again a destination, because like you saw, public spaces in Greece are not worth going to. There's no reason to go there. And this square was really designed like a building in great detail, and we treated nature as a building material. And that was the plan of it. And then in a second case is this one. It's called Square Pool. This is an existing square this is Acropolis here, again in the center. So this is two of the most important streets. And you see this square is really not used again, although it has all this potential, all these beautiful trees around and very nice buildings, especially on the other side, you will see. And it's a junky space now, like nobody goes there. And it has this small basin in the middle, like it's two steps down. So what we thought, and in fact, Athens doesn't have any water in the center. So in the summer, it's really not nice that you cannot get refreshed. So we proposed to just fill in this gap with water. So to make a shallow public pool, like other cities in the world typically have. So we made this project, Square Pool, it was called. And it became so popular that a citizens group contacted us and said, we believe in this project, we really want to do it. Citizens groups is something that is very present, very active in Athens, especially during the crisis. So people stopped waiting for government and authorities to do things, and they started doing things on their own. So one of these groups, Omada Blanco, like a Erasure group, they're called, is the one that contacted us, and they said, we really believe in it. And they found a sponsor, a German company that makes pools, and said, they're going to do it for free. And the only thing that the municipality has to do is to maintain it. So we made a model of it, and we presented it to the mayor, to the municipality. This is the model. And they were very excited about it, and they kept the model for a couple of months. And then they called us and said, we found out that unfortunately the square is listed for some reason that we're not allowed to touch it. We cannot do anything about it. So that was the end of the project. So the project took its own life in publications like this one or other ones. This was a publication in a new English newspaper, in fact, talking also about the group behind that was going to do it. Yeah, and this is a third case study, again, a square. This is the City Hall Square, so the City Hall is on this side of this space. You see, this space is really unlivable, especially in the summer, you can imagine. The fountain is very rarely working, first of all, so there's no water there. You see, there's no trees and there's no shade, so in the summer it's impossible to even cross it. And we proposed this. So we tried to make it a playful and fun space in contrast to the heavy political connotations that it has because of the City Hall there. So basically we just proposed to add water sprinkles everywhere. So basically it's like bringing a part of the countryside so in the center of Athens, because if you go outside Athens, it's all about this. So this was also in the papers. And an example of a project that is about a street. This is the main street that goes to the water from the center. It's called Tsigrou Avenue. And if you look at it today, it's like this. So it's completely not giving away this fact that it's actually heading towards directly to the islands. And a part of it gives you the view of the sea, which is amazing for a few seconds. But then there's some stuff at the end of the street that block the view, and suddenly you forget about it again. So not many people pay attention to the fact that it's this, for us, mythical condition of just heading towards the island. So we proposed instead to this project, which was to add public space, like a pedestrian and wide pedestrian tramway place in the middle with trees. And to unblock, of course, the end of the street so that you could actually see the sea again. And also to bring water-related programs along the two sides to try to just celebrate the idea of the water in the summer. And this was also in the press. And this is a small map we made for you to understand a little bit how all these projects are so related, so close. So this is the square pool, for example. This is the City Hall Square with a lawn. This is the theater square with the tall palm trees. Acropolis is here. Tsigrou starts already here. And you're going to see Six Docks Cultural Center now and Petralona House. So all these are really a couple of minutes away from each other. And that's an important part of how they are and why they are like they are. And also, if you pay attention to the images of the projects, very often you see that they become the background for the other ones. So, for example, in this project, Athens Ferry, which proposed to bring a ferry and land it on top of one of the densest student areas in the middle of the city, you can see the square pool and the theater square with the palm trees there. This is from the hills, some programs. The Faliro Pier icon is there, etc. Okay, so let's go through a few examples of realized projects also for you to have an understanding of what happens when things get done. So this is the first project we realized. It's a flower shop in Patras. So you have to realize, and that's the reason of the title of this lecture, Cooking with an Empty Fridge. Our realized projects have to deal with the total lack of resources. So there's no budget, there's no money, there's no hope usually, like it's people that don't really expect anything, and there's lack of work force, so we have to do most of the things ourselves. In this case, it was an existing flower shop that we were asked to renovate with a very small budget. So what we did was just clarify, like clean the whole space, throw everything, and create a series of tables in different proportions that could be grouped in different ways, and so that you could relate the different sorts of plants with the different tables. And then, most importantly, we created a wallpaper, see, which is, for example, this one on the one wall. which was blurry. It was a blurry image of nature. So the point was that when you enter the space, your eye gets used to the, this is the wallpaper first, and it gets used to this blurriness. So when you turn around and start looking at the plants look hyper-real, very, very sharp. And it's very shocking. It was very, it's a very shocking experience even for us, even still when you go to the space to see this happening. And also the furniture that we built, very cheap, very standard with these small white tiles, they become kind of a ruler, like a millimeter paper in the space, where all the shapes, the different shapes and colors of the plants and their leaves and all that, they become very easy to measure with your eye. I mean, not consciously, but you just relate every detail with this grid. So this is a picture. So this is how the wallpaper is. The tables with different stuff happening. And the tables actually were very much inspired by Manhattan. It was like a cityscape. So every time they moved them around, it was a different city happening. It was a very interesting thing. And there were birds sitting on the plugs and all these deals. And for the facade, we went to junkyards and looked and found this door. It's very, we do this obsessively. We collect and organize lists of things that are available for little money. So this door with the floral pattern seemed like a good thing to get. It was for 100 euros, very cheap. And we put it there. And also we put tapes with bird sounds playing in the speaker. So when you entered the shop, suddenly you got these bird sounds and it looked like, you felt like you entered the garden. That was the first project. And after that, a guy found us that he really liked the flower shop and asked us to renovate his cafe in Kalavrita, which is a mountain village in Greece, in the Peloponnese, very beautiful setting. And what we did there was just to replicate the ambience of the outside space, which has all these beautiful colors, autumn colors, because it's very high, the mountain. And so to create a space inside, well, that was all about those colors and those hues and that atmosphere. Also with a wallpaper we designed. So this is a kind of cheap tricks for us to create a strong effect. And then we realized when we did it, we realized that it really reminded us of Edward Hopper paintings, the atmosphere and the textures and colors. So we presented the project in relation to these paintings. Then because of these two projects, we got a call from some people in the center of Athens who were the owners of five different bars that were standing here, all of them completely different in their materialization, different in music. It was a mess. And it's a very interesting place because this is basically the length of a urban block. So it's very much an urban project for us. And they told us that they didn't have any money, but they had the idea to just connect their places and make one big venture out of it. And they asked us if we could do it, and we said yes. So we calculated that the budget they had was barely enough to just paint the five spaces. And that was initially, of course, a huge shock, but then we just went along with it. And we came up with a strategy, which was exactly based on color. So we said, okay, since there's going to be a gallery, a cafe, a gig space, concert space, and a night club, we realized that these programs kind of go from day to night, also from empty to full potentially, so they could be painted from white to black, and that was it. That was the project. So we couldn't buy anything, so we just took everything they had and kind of made new furniture out of it and just painted it in the corresponding colors. So this was the drawing of the project with a gallery space. So this is called Six Docks Cultural Center in Athens. It's there. It's extremely successful. This is the gallery, this is the cafe, the geek space, and the club. And this is pictures of the interiors. So gallery down, geek space here, the nightclub, and the cafe. And then what happened is that we got the license, the approval, to also use the garden in the back. So one reason that the colors we chose was just black and white was because there was this amazing hidden garden in the back, or city block courtyard, that was not visible before. And so if we could get to use it, then your eyes would get used to the black and white colors at first of the building. And then when you went under it to go to the garden, you would be even more surprised by the green you would find. This is just under the Acropolis, so there's no green at all here, Monastiraki area. This is the section of the project. So this is the six dogs, five spaces here. And there's a gap in the middle, and you go down, and then you discover this garden. And the garden, when we first stepped on it, it was like this. It had these steps. So our whole project about the garden was to convince the clients to do nothing to it. So to just celebrate the beauty of it, the trees, to buy nothing again, like it was on the spaces above. So basically, we built simple wooden furniture. We hung bulbs from the trees. We put a little bit of extra earth to make it solid on the ground, and that was it. So basically, this is an Athens project realized for us. This is some pictures of it. And this is a picture from the New York Times that recently included six dogs in the 35 reasons for somebody to visit, worth visiting Athens for. So this project has become a kind of a cult thing in Athens. And this is a typical Saturday night. This is the street, also full with people. And it really showed to us that our hypothesis was correct, that what is actually missing and what is very appropriate for Athens is not design, is just to kind of reveal what is there but hidden, like the potential, the hidden potential, the hidden beauty of the city. And soon after, the same guys from Six Dogs asked us, commissioned us, to do something in the gallery space. This is the gallery space. And they said they would invite different types of artists, like a sound musician, a choreographer, a dancer, a visual artist, a sculptor, etc. They would invite them all to engage with each other, and they wanted us to create a kind of set for them. So we said, instead of designing something new, let's replicate the actual gallery space, but in half its size. So this was called Half Real, this project. So you see, it's exactly the same space, but inside itself. So that people actually have a kind of Alice in Wonderland effect, because they suddenly become out of scale, big. We built it with blue foam. It was very cheap, again, and pretty successful. And this is an example of any residential project, because you're not seeing much of that, where you see that the same techniques apply also into the housing projects. So they get a kind of strong visual or graphic treatment that basically kind of works with what is already there. For example, in this apartment, it was really messy on one side with the toilets and bathroom storages, weird balconies, a staircase. It was really a mess. So what we did was just treat all the surfaces with the hues of green and blue, because also the trees, there's trees behind that wall, and leave the rest of the apartment, the rest of the space, just empty and white and luxurious feeling. So to have a clear, dense, and an open environment. And in this project, this is a competition we won in Tel Aviv recently, and we built. It was asking for a prototypical shade structure for public spaces, so something very cheap that could be replicated. So what we proposed was to use the typical sunshade that we have all over Greece, all over the balconies of polykatikias, which is very durable and very cheap, and to create a module that's 10 meters long by 2.5 wide, so very thin and long. And in the competition phase, we proposed putting six of these modules together. So the point was that you would create kind of little light monuments in the city, very strong, clear gestures that have the power to give shape and identity to the public space. So we won this project, and we built three modules outside of the Holon Design Museum in Tel Aviv. This opened last summer. It's so successful that they decided to keep it permanent, because it was supposed to be only for the summer. So this is a few images of that. And in the first Chicago Architectural Biennale, just this fall, like Giovanna mentioned, we took part with a project that was very interesting for us as well. It was doubles, a presentation of doubles of our projects. So what we did was present always a realized project to the left, together with an urban Athens project to the right, because we ourselves at some point discovered that there was all these same ideas that kept from the Athens project that kept feeding the real projects. And basically we realized that there was no preconception of scale with these projects, or preconception of what design disciplines are, what is urbanism, what is interior design. So basically what had been happening is that we had been treating buildings like furniture and mountains like objects, and so there was no difference between. So for example, in this case, we were sewing together Athens Heaven with a flower shop, because it's exactly the same thing, creating a podium for nature, bringing nature to the state of the protagonist. This was Theater Square that you saw in Calavrita Cafe, a tribute to nature again. This is Nadia Apartment, another one housing project we realized recently, together with Faliro Pier. It was like the center table, like the station in the sea of other stuff. Georgia Apartment, together with Athens as an island. The stair, the main stair, central construction with a stair in Nadia Apartment, together with Acropolis in the middle of Athens by hills. The exposed concrete wall of Petralona House, together with the reading of Athens as a plateau under the ferry boat. And this is the last category, which is more recent works, where I'm going to tell you the story of sponsorships. So in order to get things done, to do architecture in these conditions, where budgets are really small for us, we started to look for sponsors. It all started with this project, the marble mural, where we were asked by a commercial exhibition of materials to do something with any material we wanted. So they were expecting that we would use something kind of new, like a Korean or plastics. But instead we chose to work with marble, because that's the most archetypical Greek material, and also it's completely not exploited its potential. It's only used in bathrooms and kitchen tops as as something luxurious and to show wealth. So what we did was go to visit all the marble quarries in Athens and choose different types of marbles, and with as many faults and stains as possible. So in fact, this was pieces that had no market value, but for us it was the most interesting ones because they told the most stories. And the point was to work with these found stories, elements. So we contacted companies, and everybody we found somebody for everything, agreed to do for free. So the idea was to apply, because you never see anything other than clean, perfect marble, polished marble. So the idea was to try all kinds of techniques on marble, because we had never seen that before. So we would laser cut it and water jet it and digital print it, paint it, sculpt it, do anything we could. So we chose this series of pieces, which were very different to each other, and put them together like this. We made a wall 2 meters by 10 meters long. This was the design of the different faces, like cutting the holes and then engraving it, then printing, digital printing, and then bringing sculptor and painter to do things on it. And this was the result. So you see that all the design was kind of working with what was already there, and that's what happens with all these projects that we do. Also the Athens project, that they just try to capitalize on what's there. So for example, this marble, brown marble here, really beautiful. It really looked like an elephant skin, so we printed an elephant on it, for example. Or this one, the Casablanca piece, was like gold, so yellow gold, so we printed a queen and a lion. This one was like water, so we printed the Niagara Falls. This was like a photocopy machine, so we printed the photocopy machine on it, etc. It was very interesting because every person that worked on it had no idea what the result would be like. Also, we didn't. It was all about the process, and just dealing with each piece. And also to counteract the fact that marble is considered to be this super luxurious, expensive thing, which is not in Greece, we presented it as a billboard, like a very commercial, cheap thing. This is the back of it, where you see that it was also sculpted, so there were weird light effects going on, because it becomes transparent when it's too thin. And some pictures from the different techniques applied. So this project was all done with no cost, because just companies decided to collaborate. And then we decided to start a project, do a project, which was a personal investment for us. So we took this existing house, which is, this is the Parthenon here, it's in the back of the Acropolis. So it's a very weird, dense condition with a triangular plot, a very low value. And we decided to use it to make a house out of it, and to add, so by adding a thing on top. So to add a small floor here and a bigger one on top. And this was the design of it. So it was bringing different elements that we would find in markets and have collect on trips and all and that. So this is the, again, the design. It's like a Villa Savoie, a modern top floor over a more traditional Greek house below. This is the different sides of it. And then it had to have, we decided to give it a curved top here in order for the light to still reach the garden, because it's, like I told you, it's really packed, the plot. And this is the main wall, concrete, exposed concrete wall, that would have all this stuff engraved in it, in the concrete. And what happened is that at the same time we were doing this project, Nadia Apartment, which finished last year, and it got a lot of publicity. And people in magazines were asking us about the materials we used. So we realized that we were basically doing free advertisement for these companies. So in the, this is the ground floor and the top floor, very different and different materials. So we decided to start contacting companies proactively and asking them to give us stuff for free for the other house we were building. And it worked. So we found companies for more or less everything. So we got all the bathrooms for free, bathroom materials for free, most of the floors, all the electricity stuff, the plugs and all that, some paints. And so this was the plans of it. So that was the only way we could get to do it. And what is the case is that, of course, you have to be very inclusive. Architecture is like that. So we don't have a preconception that it has to be this floor or this material. We can just adjust to what's available to us, because that's what has been going on with every project. Whatever we have to base the design on it. And in fact, we started collecting things also from the streets, because very often you see these beautiful old wooden doors that are being replaced by aluminium new ones. So we collected doors, and we were obsessively like mapping what's available. We had these doors lying in front of our meeting table for nearly a year, in fact, like constantly replacing it with other ones if we found other ones that we thought were more potential. This is an example of the library we have of doors from court junkyards in Athens, very affordable. And then, of course, we started to invest our own time in order to do the project, building the house ourselves. So this is my partner, Mariana, and my brother and her brother building the zebra wall, which is in the entrance of the house. This is me in the courtyard of our office, cutting all the stripes, the wooden stripes. This is how it looks now. Then we had the mezzanine, a very Dali-like blobby beam that holds the mezzanine that we made like a model ourselves. Carved it in white foam. So the whole house actually was like us building a huge model, a model in one-to-one scale. This is us at Christmas cutting the stair pieces, because also the workers we work with are so uneducated that they cannot read drawings. So that's another part of this whole process, that we have to communicate everything basically with replicating it in a model first. This is us putting up the metal, a very complex metal stair here. This is Mariana making a model of the handrail for the workers. And even with more like basic architectural elements, like the profile to do the curved roof, we had to make it ourselves. So this is us connecting different pieces and putting the profile for the roof together. And then there was a graphic wall looking towards the Acropolis that we went up on the scaffoldings, of course, and painted it. And different tiles collected from old factories that are closing that we put in the concrete, in the woodwork. So this is the entryway with these tiles, for example, there, cast in the concrete. And this is the house a few months ago. The balcony, for example, this one is an old balcony from a junkyard. This is an island marble piece on top of the window. This is a little bit more recent. This is the back side with a graphic wall up there. Concrete wall, a terrace on the ground floor. This is the bedroom in the middle, in the first floor, with the beautiful handmade tiles that we were given from a factory on Creta Island. This is the doors that you saw in the street. Really beautiful, I think. We put this typical island shelves on it, for example. This is also tiles, old tiles found in junkyards, very cheap. So basically we managed to do it. So it's still something's waiting to happen. So this interior elevation will look like this. There's going to be a tree in the middle actually here. So this looks like a building inside. Another view of it. And I'm going to finish with this one. This is the most recent project. This is a playground that we took the initiative to propose to a municipality in Athens. We had the playgrounds are really the same in Athens, and there's no imagination. It's just toys spread around on the site. And we proposed a playground where kids would play together. So we proposed a colorful floor, a billboard where they could draw with lights, and a fence. And then we started looking for sponsorships because, like you saw, we have started to become kind of experts in that. But nobody, we found nobody to sponsor us for these elements. But looking for those elements, we accidentally found another sponsor, which is a company in Thessaloniki, Octopus, which sells these kinds of standard toys that all the playgrounds have. So we just changed the concept and the design and adapted to this. So this is a typical toy that we were given. And what we did was we took a... Actually, the municipality asked us to change the site into a circular square that they have. And we put together all the toys in a circle so that all the kids would feel like they would play together and they would look at each other while playing. And we went through a very long series of administration meetings for safety reasons. And at the end, we got the approval, and that was this was the design. This is the final design. And then it went on the newspapers. This is last Saturday, actually, less than a week ago. And when I landed in Montreal, the first email I saw afterwards was that we've actually found the last bit of funding that we were missing. So it seems that the playground will open in May, in a couple of months. So that's it. So what I want you to remember from all these projects is that the fact that they get published and people engage with them create a kind of public awareness of architecture that also makes a kind of critical new public imagination of the city and what it can be. And that's the most interesting or important part of the work for us. Thank you.